there is a picture, and we can see one strange thing about this picture. It's known as face bomb, that every person in this picture has the same face. It's quite easy. It's very easy for anyone who has some time to use Photoshop or any other editing tools and modify the images. And then such pictures get viral very easily. And then we have a lot of discussion and gossips over the internet for basically usually during the time of elections and all. So it's a very good time pass. So we are working on this, some algorithms, how to work on these. So I'm Sonal Kukreja, and I'm here to work about image manipulation detection techniques. So this is one more example of manipulated picture. Here, just the background has been changed, and the news was viral that the pilot was clicking the photo in air, but actually the photograph was clicked on ground. So it's quite easy to modify such images. So the most common algorithms, the most common techniques in Photoshop which we have to modify are these. Like most of them, one way is that we just change the background. That's known as alpha matting. That we have, like the previous picture I shown, this is an example of alpha matting. That is, we just change the background and the foreground is the same. And there are some other, like we can pick up one object from another image, paste it there. So all these algorithms, these techniques are used to modify the images in the Photoshop. These are some common terminologies which we used. Fake image. Fake image means if you have copied some object from other image and pasted it here. Pristine images are images in where we have not modified any object, but we have resized or changed the brightness or lightening or some sort of this stuff. So again, it's given us some wrong information. And then we have image splicing. Image splices, and again, like there are two types. One is copy move, in which we are picking the object from one image and pasting there itself. Another is image splicing, where we are cropping the object from other image and pasting it here. So these are some prominent terminologies used in manipulation. Like this is photo of India, which we usually get every Diwali. Like this is the photograph of India being captured from satellite during Diwali, but it's actually a normal satellite image. But just adding the lightning effects and all, we get the manipulated image. So no new content has been added into this, but still it's giving the wrong information. So this is a pristine image. This is again image splicing. The background has been changed and it seems to be real. So basically in these algorithms, we work on that part on which our human eyes cannot detect, or we cannot detect the difference between the original and the manipulated image. So we want to work, like in most of the image processing techniques, we work on the pixels, which can be just calculated and manipulated. But some parts which are normal, human eyes cannot detect, we need to focus on that parts in these algorithms. Again, the person was not actually sitting there, but a complete person has been made to sit on that chair. So these are images of examples of image splicing. So when we work on image forgery, this is also known as image manipulation or image forgery detection techniques, there are two approaches. One is active approach, which is sort of traditional right now, and another is passive approach. What's the difference is that in the active approach, I am the owner, I am a photographer, suppose, and I have an album of images and I want to protect them. So I have a set of images, I need to protect them. So I use the active approach, in which I know that this is the particular set of images on which I need to target upon. So earlier, a lot of research work has been done on digital watermarking and digital signatures, in which I embed the watermark into the image, and later if anyone modifies the image or wants to prove his own copyright on that image, so I can prove that easily. While in the passive approach, these days, the requirement of passive approach is more, because in the passive approach, it is like you just get a random image and we need to know whether it's original image or it's a manipulated image. So in the passive approach, we do not have the data set initially. We need to have some good algorithms in which we can detect whether this image is the original or manipulated one. So in the passive approaches, we usually, a lot of research work is been going on these techniques in computer vision. We usually study the characteristics of image, either on the basis of the neighboring pixels or the relationships between the various objects placed on that image, or through which camera it was taken, the relationship between them. So there are many attributes on which the techniques are being worked. So I will first show a brief overview of digital watermarking, like how this technique works and how the passive approach technique works. So what is in digital watermarking? That you have an image, like suppose I have an host image, we devise some algorithm. There are both types of approaches. Either the watermark can be visible, as you might have seen some, we have the TV channels or we have the images in which the owners embed their watermarks. So the watermark can be visible or it can be invisible. It depends on the requirement. So we have the host image, we have the embedding algorithm, and this is the watermark. Using that algorithm, I embed the watermark. I have shown an example of invisible watermarking. So the watermark is not visible in the marked image. Marked images in which the watermark has been embedded. Then it is sent through an insecure channel. Here the requirement is that we should know what the embedding algorithm was used, and it should be reversible so that we can use the same extracting, the reverse of the same embedding algorithm, which we can call as extraction algorithm, and extract the watermark. Now, if we are able to extract the watermark the way it is, that usually means the image is not tampered, or we can use it for copyright protection also, that we can prove that this image is ours. So one modification to this, like in the main disadvantage of watermarking techniques was that it actually, we need to embed the watermark into the image, which modifies the pixels of the image. So that somehow destroys the quality, though it can, won't be visible to the human eyes, but it destroys the quality of the image. Another technology came into picture, which is known as visual cryptography. What do we have in visual cryptography? Like we might have, you might be knowing some cryptography techniques, that we have some data, we have a key, we encrypt that data, send that data. If someone wants to decrypt it, he can use the decryption algorithm or he can use the same key and decrypt it. What was special about visual cryptography was that in the visual cryptography, we have the image. I just divide, like the most common example on which this technique was developed is, like suppose we have a common bank account, and suppose I and one of my family member, we both have a joint account, or we have, suppose we have a locker there. So when we have a locker, there are two keys used to open that locker and access it. Even if one person goes and tries to access it, he cannot. So this is a secret sharing technique that in the visual visual cryptography was working on the same principle, that there is a set of participants and they all have a right over the image. I want to give rights to all of them, so I divide the image to all the people. Like I have five people, so I divide the image into five shares. All of them would have one share each. When all those shares which I have given to those five people, when I overlap them, the secret image should be retrieved back. So this was like I divided the two shares. With the individual two shares, you cannot just assume what information is hidden behind them. But when you overlap it, it has a very easy decryption algorithm. So when you overlap it, the secret hidden behind is retrieved. So this same thing we use as watermarking. This technology is sometimes used on, like, this can be used in real time in cloud applications and all when we want to give rights to more than two people. So we have an host image. Now, we are not embedding the watermark inside the host image, but we are creating a feature matrix from it using different feature extraction techniques. I create a feature matrix from it, applying some algorithm on feature matrix, I create a master share. Then using the master share and the watermark, I create an ownership share, which is again a different image. But later, when I want to prove, now I can send this host image to an insecure channel. I have not embedded any watermark into it, but still it is protected. This is the modification of watermarking. How? Like I received the host image again through an insecure channel. I again used, again extracted the features, created a feature matrix, created a master share, overlapped it with the ownership share, which I had created in the previous phase. This ownership share is usually stored with the participant. So from the disputed image, I create the master share, I take the ownership share, overlap them, and I should get the extracted watermark. In this original image, this was a simple scenery. in which I modified the image and added that cloud and three birds there. So when I extract the watermark, in that watermark, again, a boundary of the cloud and the birds is being shown. That means this particular area was tampered. Now in this technique, I did not modify the actual image. I just created a share, secret thing, gave it to the owner. He has that key with him. Whenever he gets the image, we can apply the same algorithm, get the master share, overlap them, and see whether the image is tampered or not. So this can be like, if we have a printed image, we can print the shares on the transparent sheets, we overlap it, we can see that retrieved watermark onto it, or we can scan it using our phones. Sir, in some techniques, like in medical technique, in medical images, even if you are embedding the watermark into it, even if we are embedding watermark into it, and even if it's not visible to human eyes, but the actual pixels are being modified. So in some like crucial applications, I just give an example of medical application, even a one change in the pixels can result into wrong assumptions. So in such crucial applications, we need that the image should not be modified. So when I created an algorithm on this visual cryptography, so I have not shown all the results here, but this was one image, a cameraman. I just wrote smile please here, and when I retrieved it, the smile please, some distorted area was being displayed on the watermark. So that showed that this particular block of image is being tampered. Same is this is the same example which I showed in the algorithm. Then we come to the passive approach, where presently I am studying and like trying to work. I don't have any good definite results right now, but I'm still working on this field, that how we can use neural networks on the passive approach to detect the manipulation in the images. So this is the basic diagram of CNN, which we know that we have some input data, we have an input image, we have a set of hidden layers inside it. In the hidden layers, we have the convolution layer and the pooling layers, and activation function layer also in between. So we can have a set of hidden layers in between. Then I have the fully connected layer, which are used for classification, and then I finally used for the output layer. Now, how we are going to use this? How this will work, suppose I have an image, I input that image, I will apply the convolution layer and the pooling layer on it. The convolution layer is usually applied, like we have a weighted matrix, we are multiplying it with the image matrix which we have. The convolution layer is usually used to extract the features from the image, studying the neighboring pixels, considering the neighboring pixels into picture, we extract the information about a particular block of image using the convolution layer. Then using the pooling layer, out of all those pixels, we try to reduce the size. So we just pick up, on the basis of some functions which I will discuss, we pick up some pixels which can represent all of the neighboring pixels there, and so that we can reduce the size. So like this is an example. I have an image, I applied a weighted matrix to it. These weighted matrix, these weights, decision on how these weights should be taken. Also, we have different techniques available that I tried for Xavier initialization. In Xavier initialization, the concept is that the variance of the input and the output should be same. So anyways, we can use the weights. We multiply the weights and we get a different matrix. When we get a different matrix, okay, we apply the pooling operation, like for we can apply average pool or we can apply max pool. We have a block from every block of 4 pixels. Like I took a max pool with 2x2 filters. So for every 2x2 block, I have taken the maximum value. Yeah, I have taken the maximum value there. So this is an example of max pool. We can take average pool also. So although still in some, like I'm starting into this part also, like when we are reducing the size, sometimes it might happen that some information can be lost because we are just ignoring the other pixels, but still, they still represent the neighboring pixels there. So what is usually how the detection algorithms based on CNN work? That we have a set of images, some training images, some test images. So there is a deep learning model. We just input the feed images, initialize the weights initially, which keeps on get updated using the backpropagation. Then once we have trained the model, After that, we can, this is a general example of neural network. Then we feed the images from the artist, and then it can classify whether that image is an original image or the manipulated image. So this was one of the algorithm in recent conference papers that I was studying and working on presently, that we have an input image. They applied a high-pass filter into it. Why do we apply high-pass filter? High-pass filter is applied so that we can study the hidden image, hidden portions of the image.
These were the papers that on which, and this is again a first image of Mona Lisa, which some external things have been added. And you have.